data and information to kind of identify where that community is and what their needs are, I think is part of the conversation as well.
Well, I think definitely for New Portlanders and the other communities of color, but also especially for people with disabilities, the transportation aspects being at the top and involved, that clearly affects
And if you, and I don't want to speak on behalf of transportation, but one of the first sort of use cases for autonomous vehicles is looking at paratransit, for example, which is very expensive. You know, how we initially address the needs of folks that say that existing bus services don't meet those needs, I think is perhaps one of the first use cases we want to address with things like automated vehicles and first mile, last mile solutions that they provide.
Well, knowing the director of the retreat and her commitment, which she's demonstrated since she's become the director, I think we'll continue to do that. I saw on the consent agenda today, I don't know whether it was one of the ones that it was called, but there's a pilot of providing the bike town program to people with disabilities, and so I was really happy to see that. I just, again, if we don't call it out, it's liable to get missed, or we're liable to include people when it's really too late for them to engage in direct
things. Yes, I agree with that.
Yeah, thank you. So that's all I have to say.
We had to come back. So I have three questions for your presentation.
Sure.
The first is, look forward 10 years. And we've talked about getting in front of disruptive technology. We're talking about harnessing new technologies. These are all very high-level concepts. How will any of this benefit the average person living in our community?
Well, you know, there's a lot of different theories. The hope that people are attached to is that just from the transportation perspective, if we look at autonomous vehicles, in a 10-year time frame, perhaps we'll get to congestion relief because it's going to take some time for people to give up their personal vehicles, and that's going to be a generational change, so you'll start seeing that happen over the next 10 years. Autonomous vehicles, hopefully, are going to be safer because they're not impaired, they're not speeding, and they follow all the traffic laws. We also hope that autonomous vehicles are going to be providing mobility solutions for people in underserved areas who have lack of
computer error.
That's what we hope to see over the next 10 years, and why the private sector is investing so heavily in this, is that's the aim. I personally, my sentiment or thought is it's going to take up to 15 years until we hit that tipping point or perhaps more. It's also going to greatly impact our
downtown
infrastructure,
all
says transportation.
You're on the freeway.
In the next 10 to 20 years, our largest funding source, in addition to the gas tax, parking revenue, and autonomous vehicles or any kind of autonomous mobility solutions have the possibility to greatly carve into parking revenue because it won't be necessary anymore. So we need to be thinking extensively about how we're going to fund transportation infrastructure as we think about technologies.
So that's helpful, and I think we ought to continue to work to be able to describe this as and the community benefits in plain English, because I think when we start using terms like smart cities, I think it excludes most people. And the assumption is that any questions you have about it means you're part of the dumb
there's,
city movement.
There's Nick Fish insulting the people of Portland.
How does it actually benefit my prison? All this stuff is how is someone who lives here benefited from this? Not how do we leverage technology per se, but how does that improve the quality of life of someone who lives here? The second question I have is, because your presentation talks so much about disruptive technology, I'm obliged to just note that the last time someone came into Portland with a so-called disruptive technology, it was Uber. And the track record of Uber is they came in and ran over regulators and ran over consumers. What assurances do we have through this process, particularly with companies like Uber and others looking at autonomous vehicles, that we're going to be regulating ahead of the curve and not dealing with rogue actors?
Frankly, we don't have those assurances in place. Uber and Lyft, the TNC market is linked up with the big auto industry, so Ford, GM, and BMW, the three largest financial backers of the autonomous vehicle initiative, and they are linked up with Uber and Lyft, and they are working very hard at the federal level to get federal preemption, so even states could not regulate their own markets, much less they're also working at the state level to try to preempt at the state level for localities to have local regulations. So it's something that we really need to stay on top of and be mindful of.
So since you mentioned that, we as a council oppose Uber's effort to preempt all local regulations of TNC. Is there something in this legislative session that has been filed which would preempt cities and localities from regulating autonomous vehicles?
Yes, there has, and it failed.
So when you say that there'll be an effort to preempt at the federal and state level, we know these large companies are very successful at doing that. And we also know that one of the primary drivers that we're hearing about with this technology is that by taking the driver out of the car, they lower the cost. That's not just disruptive, that may actually be catastrophic to the workplace, and it also raises, in my mind, safety issues. Do we have the authority to mandate that even with autonomous vehicles, there be a driver?
There's nothing, to my knowledge, there's nothing that precludes a local government to stipulate that in our code. I think that's a question for the attorneys, but I can tell you it doesn't exist now.
So Mayor, I'm going to, looking at what's happening in Singapore and other places where these companies have come in on a very aggressive timeline to put autonomous in and then promptly move to driverless. I think, and given our experience with Uber and the way they push the envelope, I think I would ask that that be addressed at the front end of this process. And my sense is that if we're very assertive and aggressive about requiring a driver in an autonomous vehicle early on, at least we have the leverage to make sure that we get it right as it unfolds. And so that's my third point. And my final point, I just want to acknowledge, is that your steering committee contains government agencies, utilities companies, and I know, you know, it is TriMet, makes sense, PG&E, Daimler, that makes sense. I'm assuming they're going to be doing autonomous trucks. Uber, are Lyft and taxis on that steering committee?
No.
So why have we chosen the worst actor in the industry to be on the steering committee and not Lyft or taxis?
So the steering committee is just made up of internal staff. We have relationships with outside committees like the Regional Smart Cities Group and the Private Smart Cities Lab, where those folks are participating. But our steering committee is really meant to be an internal place for coordination. So currently it involves PBS, PBOT, EBM, OCT, BTS, Prosperport, Portland, the Portland Housing Bureau, representatives from the mayor's office, representatives from Commissioner Saltzman's office, and representatives from Commissioner E. Daly's office. And we hope to expand that to include other folks in the city as well. But for now, the steering committee is an internal.
Okay, so we're doing this in phases. Do I have your assurance that when you are engaging external stakeholders, both Lyft and traditional taxis will be given the same standing as Uber as part of a stakeholder process?
I think that's the intention.
Is that a yes or a no?
Yes.
And so, Mayor, I'll be looking to publish a list at the appropriate time that has all the stakeholders. And I would like to see the taxi industry given full standing. And I would also, frankly, I don't use Uber for all the obvious reasons. I have started using Lyft, particularly when I have no other option, and I have found them reliable and professional. And frankly, their business practices, to me, are discernibly different than Uber. But I think they all need to be at the table if we're going to get this right.
Yeah, and I think, just briefly, one of the first tasks of the steering committee is to lay out sort of what we're calling a playbook. Other cities have done this as well. And that's really, how do we lay out sort of the lanes for the private sector to engage with the city? How do we make it consistent and vendor agnostic so that everybody has the same
opportunity? What do you call it when corporations become part of the government?
With the various private sector players. And we let them know, okay, if
fascism,
you want to work with the city, here's what our goals are. What we want to accomplish. Here's how you engage with us. And I also think, just wanted to reiterate the point, these technologies, again, are coming whether we want them to or not. If we do nothing, there are potentially very negative
implications fire, to some of
these technologies, like autonomous vehicles. We could see significant increases in vehicle trips, and we could see significant decreases in transit ridership, for example, and how we as a city really lay down the policies, and that's where I think PBOC is doing such innovative work to sort of prevent the dystopian future that you know, could be a possibility.
They really ought to shut down.
So I think looking at this from some of these outcomes can be negative. If the city is not effective, is a place that we're really wanting the steering committee to come from.
Thank you. And I want to pick up on one of the issues that she spoke to, which was about the value to the community member. Commissioner Davis out to the Country and City Business, but if she was here, I'm sure she would express concern about the capacity of the one city staff person who is responsible for talking to people in the community about equity, which is Ashley Horn, in her leadership of staffing of the Public Involvement Advisory Committee. So I'm concerned about, I didn't see either the Office of Neighborhood Involvement or the Office of Equity and Human Rights on any of those, here's the projects we're doing. And I also, so I know.
Yeah, no, I think that's really good feedback. I think our intentions are there. We have failed to communicate it in our graphics and our presentations. So thank you, and we will expand upon that.
Well, if it is supposed to be just city staff, I guess my point is I don't think Ashley has any more capacity to attend to another major project. So I would encourage you to broaden the steering committee to include community members who can provide a perspective that
not white in the city.